Folks, welcome to the Jake Feinberg Show. I'm joined tonight by one of the most unheralded cats, you know, that has been, you know, in the music scene. Also, somebody who was, you know, deeply connected to special people along the way. And it's an honor to welcome in Greg Collier to the Jake Feinberg Show.
How you doing, Jake?
Greg.
Hey, buddy.
Yeah. No. I mean. I wanted to ask you about. Did you play in any jug bands?
No jug bands. That's not something I've done. I've done some country music and other things along the way, but no jug bands.
I mean, specifically back, like when you first, like when did would you say you got your first professional gig?
Geez, that was probably back in the early '70s. I was doing some just clubs around different things. I had the opportunity to open for Gene Clark and Orange at a little place over in Orange one time, and just different places around. I had some, you know, local stuff I did. And kind of what happened to me, I was playing at a party down in Corona Del Mar. Just everywhere I'd go, I'd take my guitar when I had an opportunity to play. And a good friend of mine, I was playing some music with, his girlfriend was having a party down there. So I just showed up that one night and just sitting around doing some music on a piano. And somebody was listening to me and liked what I was doing, and we got acquainted. And it turned out it was a guy named Tony Benedict, who was had been an animator for Hanna-Barbera, and he was doing an animated movie, and he wanted to know if I'd help him do some music for it. And he had Donovan and a bunch of other people that were contributing, so that was an opportunity for me that I couldn't really pass up. So I went ahead and did that, and kind of, you know, how things go, one thing's a stepping stone to another. But because of that situation and us recording the album, actually it's a double album, quadraphonic album for the soundtrack for the movie, but we were rehearsing to do a kind of a promotional concert for the movie down in San Diego, and John Backdorf and his wife Melanie happened to come to that rehearsal, and that's where I got a little bit better acquainted with them. I'd actually met them before. Actually, that's where I met my first wife, is one of their shows on Friday the 13th.
Were you in the LA? Was that the first time you were in the studios, the LA studios, with the Hanna-Barbera stuff?
I'd done some demo tapes before that, and I was, you know, doing like a lot of musicians, you know, doing, trying to get their demos out, and that wasn't going anywhere. I'm sure they ended up in the trash can, or like most people's do, but I had gone in the studio to record some things like that, but it was then they took us in. It was called Cherokee Studios later on, off of Cherokee there and in Hollywood. We went in and recorded two of my songs. One was called Falling Down, and another song was called The Hawk. And that's, we did those for the movie. That was my first kind of big time, you know, as far as recording something. So.
Yeah, no, because I've interviewed all the cats, all the guys that were like, after the Wrecking Crew, you know, great percussionists like Emil Richards, who was like doing the Flintstones stuff and the Hanna-Barbera. I just can't believe that at this party, this guy. I guess it's just, that's just the way it works, you know. I mean, a cat. Go ahead.
No, it really kind of does go that way. I mean, it's always kind of amazed me. I mean, I spent so much energy running around trying to take these demo tapes around, you know.
Yeah, right.
Sure, didn't do a whole heck of a lot, but then just meeting one person, you know. It's like stepping stones to somebody else, and that's kind of how things go. And I used to have friends of mine that were, in my opinion, way more talented than I was, you know, and they'd ask me, how did you get to do this, you know, the opportunity to do a hit song and all that kind of stuff. And shoot, I never really had any answers for them as far as any set way to do this or that, because I just kind of stumbled onto it. But, you know, I don't know if we stumble on anything. I think there's, you know, things happen for a reason sometimes. But basically what I told them is I just had a real passion for it. I would take my guitar everywhere I went and played it every chance I had for whoever, and that's what I did. And with a real passion and desire to be able to someday, hopefully, you know, do some music. And unfortunately, I was able to, you know, get a taste of that and do that. So,
when did you first jam with Batdorf? You know, when was the first time that you guys were? Because in my interview with him at this point, what it seemed like was that he had developed a relationship with you musically prior to the end of Batdorf and Rodney, and he started, and then something went down, but then he'd already had his ear to you, you know, and so I'm just trying to figure out the first time you guys actually jammed.
Well, he was aware of me because of, here's kind of what happened. We had a mutual friend, his name was James Lewis, and I met James down at the Sawdust Festival in Laguna Beach. I used to live down there, and you know, we became acquainted, and we jammed at the Sawdust Festival, and we started kind of hanging around together playing music, and some guys from a band called Gabriel Gladstar, and a flute player from that band. But anyways, I was just hanging out with him playing some music, and we were working on a kind of a duo type thing, and he was good friends with John Batdorf and Batdorf and Rodney and those guys, and he asked me to go up to this show on Friday the 13th, as I mentioned, and was up at the Loyola High School, and I went up there to see the band play. And I'd also gotten to McCabe's and seen him play there one time with him as well. But that night after the show at the Loyola, we all went back to the band's house and, you know, hung out and partied with them, spent most of the night there. And that's, as I mentioned, that's where I met my first wife, Bernie, and that's kind of where things started with us. But as from that whole thing, we're just hanging out, partying and stuff like that, and then I don't know, it was sometime after that I was doing this rehearsal, as I mentioned, and I guess James maybe had invited him. I'm not sure how he actually showed up, but John Batdorf and his wife Melanie were there, and I guess I wasn't aware of what was going on, but I guess apparently at that time there were some other, you know, issues going off the band that that John had some reservations about continuing on with, and I was just at my house. I lived out in Carbon Canyon at the time, and James showed up at my house one night. He was kind of bummed out. I go, "What's going on?" He goes, "Well, I hate to even tell you this." I go, "What?" And he goes, "But John wants you to call him. He's interested in getting the band together with you, because James knew if I did that, there wouldn't be much chance of me and him doing anything together." But I called John, and it was actually in December of 76, and then he arranged for me to come up. So he was living in Cagle Canyon, and he arranged for me to come up, and, you know, I met the Brent and the rest of the guys and stuff. We hung out and did some, you know, just hung out. But he wanted to, the night I went out and actually met Brent and everything, he wanted to kind of see how our vocal blend would work and everything. So we sat down and took a couple of our tunes, and we worked up some harmonies, and it was pretty much, there was magic in the air, man. There was just something special about the way the vocals blended and the sound and everything. It was something you could definitely feel.
This is, you're really putting years on my life at this point, man. I really appreciate it a lot. It's beautiful like, how would you, I guess, I mean, it's still hard for me to figure out, though, like, first of all, do you have tapes of, because I mean, Batdorf said that you did hang a mic over because you guys played every day for a while.
Oh yeah, shoot! I mean, once we decided it was a goal, we started, decided we were actually. I guess maybe I was a little unaware of the timelines of everything that's ever, you know, the pressure of getting things done. But I guess we had a week to get our management in place, and then we had another week after that to play for Clive. And so we literally, I just, even though I was living in Carbon Canyon at the time, I just basically moved in with John and Melanie and brought my sleeping bag, and we were spending probably at least 14 hours a day rehearsing. We'd get up at 9 o'clock or, you know, the first thing in the morning, and we'd drink some tea and start in about 9 o'clock and go till about 11 that night, and you know, I'm surprised we had any voices left, but we just rehearsed, tried to get it as tight as we could, and then about a week later we had John Hartman and Harlan Goodman, who at the time, they were managing America and Poco, I think, and they came out to listen to us and John's place, his little studio place in Cable Canyon, and we kind of blew them out of the water. You know, they said that they got goosebumps when we played, and that was for them. They said, you know, later on I heard that was what was a deciding factor. If they got goosebumps, they felt that there was something, you know, special enough about a band that they were interested in. So they became our management, represented us, and then a week later, I'm sure John told you this, but we went in at the Beverly Hills Hotel and played for Clive Davis and some of the people from there stood around. And it was pretty scary. You know, I was, one of the most scary times I've been in my life. I was shaking so bad I could hardly tune my guitar or drink water or anything. But we managed to get through it, and they liked it enough they wanted to sign us. How was Brent
doing that day? Was he freaking out too?
Brent, he'd been out touring and playing and with Bad River and Roddy. This is kind of me just stepping into the big time. So I may have been more nervous than him. I don't know, but I'm sure we were all nervous. There was a lot on the line.
What's fascinating, I mean, again, it's I wasn't even born at that point, you know, but it's like, what's fascinating is that I would have been, knowing what not being able to hear the trio, I just feel like the trio was really the appealing part of it, and I wonder how it would have worked if it just was a trio. I mean, there was never any possibility that there'd be no rhythm section.
It almost turned out to be that. I'm not exactly sure if it was the end game or not, but originally when we got started the group off, the idea was Brent and John and myself as the main, you know, the vocal core, and we were the songwriters and the vocalists, but he used to go by John Masseri, but he goes by John White now. But anyways, John White was the drummer, and Rick Carlos was the bass player from Bat Dorf and Rodney, so, you know, it was just kind of a natural thing to kind of use those guys as the rhythm section. But when we started doing rehearsals at the Crossroads, for whatever reason, John and Harlan showed up, our management, and they were, I would say, underwhelmed would be a good word, with what was going on, and they just didn't seem like they were happy with the direction it was going with the full band. And so we had a meeting, and you know, they were having second thoughts even about continuing on managing us at the time, but we decided, you know, if we went back to a trio, that was something that would work for them, and, you know, they basically wanted this to be more like a Crosby, Stills, Nash type of trio, I think. So we went back to being a trio, and after that, John went on to play drums with, you know, Jackson Brown and Hoyt Axe and a lot of different people. He went on to have a pretty good run of things himself, and Rick went on to play, you know, him and John both, and Brent later on played with Bobby Weir's band, Bobby and the Midnight.
Oh, absolutely. No, I'm a little, you got to help me out here, though. I thought that you guys went in the day you stepped into the big time, Clive liked it, and then this Harry Stenson and Tom Ledden were the rest of the group, but you're saying it was Carlos and Masseri.
Well, initially when we first started rehearsing, but then, as I mentioned, Hartman Goodman, they wanted this to be more of a trio at that time, so, you know, it wasn't necessarily what the band wanted to do, but we had to, you know, we had to let John and Rick, you know, let them go and say we're going back to trio. So they went their own ways and pursued what they did, and then we rehearsed as a trio for some time. And we actually, our very first gig we did was at the Golden Bear.
Oh my God, I'm obsessed with that. That was like a honky tonk bar.
Yeah, well, we opened down there for Eric Anderson and as a trio. So actually, as a trio, we did some vocals on Eric Anderson's one of his albums, and Timothy Schmidt and different people helped out on it.
Really? Wow.
Yeah. Neat experience to be in the studio and getting shoulder to shoulder with one of these people who've been an idol to you, you know, so it's kind of cool. But anyways, that was our first gig, and then we did that for a while, and then one day John and Harlan approached us where they had some ideas with some other guys that they wanted us to look at as far as band members, and Harry Stinson, he had been playing with Dolly Parton and Ronnie Millsap. He was from Nashville, so he'd been playing with some pretty hardcore, you know, well-known country people back there, but most recently he'd been touring with America because Willie Leacock, I think, was the drummer. He broke his arm or something, couldn't tour, so they had Harry playing drums with him during that time, and I guess that's when Hartman and Goodman got, you know, familiar with him since they were managing America. But they had him and then Tom Ledden, who, before he moved out and joined our band, he was in a band with Tom Petty back in Florida called Mudcrutch.
Really? Did they ever cut an album? Any LPs for that album?
About 5 years ago, Tom Petty actually put back together the original old Mudcrutch band he had.
And they
did a studio album. You should check it out. It's a really good album. And then they did a live album, too. But then Tom Beck went back to doing his heartbreaker stuff, that's a thing. So, but anyways,
this is so classic.
Tom had also been playing with Johnny Rivers' band while he was out here for a while before he joined our band. But after he joined our band, from what I understand, that kind of lit a fire under Tom Petty to move his band out here and try to get a deal too, since we had our hit song going on and stuff like that. But
You said something. Just for the audience, explain that they were looking for you to be more of a Crosby, Stills, and Nash trio as opposed to fill in the blank. I mean, are you talking power?
I think they had more of a vision of just an acoustic vocal type thing. I'm not even 100% sure about this, but that's, you know, the end game is we had them going back to a trio, and we did this acoustic trio for a while, and then we ended up finally... I forget his last name. Craig Fuller or somebody. His name was Craig. It was the guitar player. He'd played with Linda Ronstadt's band. And anyways, they were looking to have him be another guitar player in the band, but we already had two guitar players, a bass, and drums, and keyboard. And so we, didn't opt to have another guitar player, so we just kept to the five piece.
When you were just in the trio, would Brent play the bass pedal on the organ, or would he play bass lines?
Well, he had a Rhodes piano is what we played. He played a lot, and we did the acoustic stuff, you know. And he also had a Hammond B3, but we did that more initially when we were doing the whole band thing. I guess he used to use the B3 a lot, and after from Rodney, too. But with the Silver band, we was just mostly the Rhodes piano. Played live and rehearsed. But that's what he played. That was his instrument. John played his Martin, I played my Martin, and Brent played the acoustic, Rhodes piano, and that's what we did.
Can you talk about your relationship with Brent when you first met him, and then the kinds of things that that you guys used to, just the amount of time that you guys spent together collaborating musically? But I mean, you guys obviously spent a lot of time just hanging out. So, I mean, I would love you to talk about that cat.
You know, he was an amazing, amazing, talented person. I mean, I started to even think of words that could give him what he's doing in that regard. I mean, he was extremely talented, had an amazing voice, very soulful, and, you know, he was a nice guy. He was kind of a quiet, moody guy in some ways, you know, and... But he was very friendly. We hit it off, you know, and just got along extremely well in the band. I never had any issues at all with Brent. And after the band broke up, like a lot of times there's some, maybe ill will hard feelings for a while or whatever when things first going on. But me and Brent stayed pretty close, we were never affected by any of that kind of stuff. We just stay close, and I get to see him every once in a while. He, as I mentioned, he and John Masseri at the time, he goes by John White now, but John Masseri and Rick Carlos, they joined up with Bobby Weir's band with Bobby Cochran, and I guess they called Bobby in the Midnights, but Brent was playing with his band at the time, and I guess the Dead were going through a hard time or something, and they were kind of getting, from what I understand, kind of thinking about breaking up, and then Jerry Garcia happened to mention, why don't they give Brent a try, and the rest is history.
Yeah, well, I wasn't sure if they ever were considering breaking up, but I know they were going to get rid of, they were done with Donna and Keith, and then, like, Jerry one night heard Brent at a Bobby show and said, this cat might work. You know, the thing, I mean, Brent always struck me as somebody, he had a bit of an idiosavantish quality to him. So I remember I interviewed John Perry Barlow way back when, and he talked about Brent being, he would be able to tell you what day of the week February 27th, 2027 would be, you know.
Well, that wasn't surprising at all about him. I mean, it's like I said, it's hard to explain how his mind worked and how he grasped music and whatnot.
Yeah, I know. That's what I want to know, exactly what you just said.
Well, for me, coming from my background, the thing that kind of really lit me up and got me going writing music and just totally set me on fire as far as wanting to do music was the Buffalo Springfield band. And so, I mean, anything that came out of that, that's what motivated me. But when I got together with Brent and the Silver Band and all that, his background, I mean, I I'd studied classical piano, but he'd studied a lot of classical piano, and I don't know what else he'd studied, but that guy could play anything, and he was really, you know, where I'm more into the country rock kind of music, he was into Weather Report, John McLaughlin, Herbie Hancock, Mahavishnu, just, you know, all this jazz fusion stuff that really was something that I wasn't really too much into myself at the time. I couldn't even wrap my brain around a lot of that stuff. But now, what was really, to me, what would blow me away, we'd be doing these kind of real simple little, you know, songs and regular chords, and all of a sudden Brent would throw in some trippy, jazzy chord that was maybe dissonant, a little bit or whatever, but it would just seem to add a whole new magic and element to what we were doing. And he had a way of just doing that kind of stuff. And, you know, as I mentioned, he was kind of moody. I mean, a lot of times if he'd get his nose bent out of shape, the way he would, you know, at least I saw the way he'd deal with things, a lot of times he'd go lock himself in his room for a few hours, but he'd come emerge from this room, and he'd come out with like three or four just amazing, incredible songs that, you know, I mean, I don't write songs that way. I mean, I go for a long period of time sometimes, and then all of a sudden I'll hear something in my head and start putting down a tune or whatever, but he could just go in and write literally three or four songs that can come out and just blow you away when you play them for you. So that was, you know.
Wow. I'm just smiling ear to ear, though, because you've been the first person to validate what I hear. You know, I haven't, you know, Silver, there's just not a lot of live stuff. Obviously, the album doesn't really even do justice to what you guys did as a band. I mean, like Batdorf said, the track that got all the headlines wasn't even what the band sounded like, you know?
No, and to be honest with you, I honestly think that we're one of those few bands that actually sounded better live than we did on a recording.
Oh, I listen, there's the Grateful Dead were like that, and I guarantee you guys were like that too. I mean, it was, the thing that you just said that blew me, I love to hear the fact that Brent was just jonesing. He was a jazz funk. He was totally into that stuff.
Oh yeah, I mean he was in his. But I mean that's the way his brain worked too. He got that stuff. I didn't. I'm pretty simple. I mean I'm not real by music theory and all that. I'm pretty limited. I mean I did study classical music for 5.5 years, and I played an upright bass for a couple of years. So I used to read music, but I haven't done that stuff for so long. I can't even, you know, basically read anymore music and stuff like that. But he just had such an understanding of everything about music, and I was such a simple person. A lot of times I'd have to, you know, stumble around trying to find the right chord, and he would just know. I mean, he would know, and then he'd say, if you want to make it more interesting, add this or that or whatever. He was just, he had so much musical talent, and he had a really amazing voice, too, that was quite different, you know. In some ways, it kind of, people have compared it a little bit to Michael McDonald, but it was even different than that. It had that real, you know, soulful, a little bit of raspiness to it.
I would have given anything to be hanging out with that trio, man. What a ball. A ball. You must.
We had some fun, man. We really did. We all, you know, it was a lot of fun. We used to have a lot of fun. We recorded the bulk of the album at Indigo Ranch, which was a part owned by Michael Penner, one of the guys in the Moody Blues. That's us. A lot of neat people come through that place, but it was just a real neat environment to hang out. We just basically stayed there for a couple of weeks while we did most of the album, and we recorded some different places and whatnot too. But it was,
you played the upright. You said you played the upright bass.
I used to play upright bass.
Were you like a Scott LaFaro fanatic?
No. I was just you know, a kid in school, in junior high. You know, take orchestra or band or whatever. I was just, you know. I took upright bass. I mean, the stand-up bass is what I took, and did it for a couple of years in orchestra. But I never continued on with it. If you stuck one in my hands right now, I'd be lost. You know, I'd have to relearn it, figure it out. But it was fun. We had fun.
The what could you say about the looking back on that Silver album? You know, it seems like it might be actually resonating a little bit more, and will continue to. I mean, that's the beauty about music, is that it returns to life in different forms, you know. And you don't even realize what you're doing at that time, but then it just pops back up. And I'm just curious, getting some perspective, you know, from years of after, you know, having different, you know, tribulations in your life and going through lots of different things. I mean, Do you feel like you guys were able to enjoy that pocket of time?
That
pocket of time. I mean, that was like a place in time, you know, that could never be repeated.
Without a doubt. I mean, it is, you know, I have to say it's probably one of the highlights of my life, the high points of my life, is having that whole experience with the band and to be able to go out on the, you know, road and play in front of 25,000 people crowds, you know, open for groups like America and the Doobie Brothers and Poco and Hall & Oates and Black Oak, Arkansas. I mean, on and on. I mean, I never would have had that opportunity without, you know, knowing John Badger from Silver and the band and all that kind of stuff. And it was just, you know, we all had a good time, you know, you know, guys have gone on to do other good stuff since then, you know. John's still making really good music, and Harry's doing good music, and Tom had that, you know, thing he got to do again with Mudcrutch, you know. I'm just kind of bummed out Brent's still not around, you know.
Well, what I'm trying to say is, like, I get the feeling, like, even Brent, when he got into the Dead, I mean, you guys must have still seen each other, though.
Well, yeah, I mean, he would get a hold of me, or I'd get a hold of him whenever they were playing around, you know, when I could go see the shows, and I'd go hang out and, you know, do the whole thing backstage and party with the guys, and, you know, me and Brent would go down, close out the bars afterwards, and go back to his place, and, you know, we had fun. It was, you know, we stayed in touch, and, you know, we'd see each other when we were around each other to do that, so we kept in communication. In fact, I saw him the month before he passed. I was up in Eugene at my dad's funeral, and I'd gone to the show at Austin State in the same, and we went out, and, like I said, closed out a couple of bars. We ended up back at his place, you know, left that dinner in his room, and, you know, we just had a nice visit and everything, and little did I know that that'd be the last time I'd see him, you know. It was just heartbreaking is not even a good word to use, but it was just,
When you say when he was in town, were you talking about the Bay Area? Like, where would be the local thing, place for
him? Well, I mean, at the time I was living down in San Juan Capistrano, you know, so if they'd come by and play like Irvine Meadows or wherever they'd play around, I'd go see him down in Chula Vista. After the band broke up, Silver, I moved up to Oregon with my family and bought a house on the coast up there. And then we moved back down, and it was November of 83 when my wife, when her leukemia came back, so we had to move back down. After she passed away, April the next year, it was sometime after that that they were playing down in Chula Vista, but I wanted to go down and see Brent down there, and he invited us to come down, and I wanted to take my sons, who were 5 and 8 at the time, and it was kind of funny because they're going, "Oh, we don't want to go to that old hippie concert." They didn't want to go down and see the show, but I made them go with me anyways. And they had such a ball there, man. Backstage there, I don't know who had it, but somebody had, the guy that makes the Muppets, he had made one of those, Jerry Garcia doll, like the Muppet doll.
Yeah, sure.
So they were all, the guys in the band, everybody's back there playing around with that, and they were letting my kids play with this, so they were having fun, and everybody was making over them and all that kind of stuff. So they're having a good time. And then when the show was over with, we were going to go back to the hotel and hang out. And then Billy Crisman and Phil Lesh grabbed my boys. And they go, "We're taking your boys with us." And they put them in the limousine with them. They go, "We'll meet you back at the hotel," right? So Brent and me got my car. We rode back to the hotel. And by the time we got back to the hotel, I was there when they opened up the limo's door and let my sons out. And they jumped out. And they go, "Man, this is cool." They had like Coke in their hands, you know, a can of Coke in their hands.
Oh man, this is the greatest story I've ever heard in my life.
Phil and Billy let my kids watch Punky Brewster on their TV in the car, and they thought that was the coolest thing, riding in the back of the limo with these guys. And so then all of a sudden it was a cool thing to go to a Grateful Dead show. You know, it wasn't that old hippie concert thing anymore. It was pretty funny.
Wow, this is really amazing. So, do you remember, like, when you, in the early 80s you were up in Oregon, would Brent, when they would swing up there, you guys would connect up there in the Pacific Northwest?
Yeah, and actually, and then when I would take trips down to California too, when I go through the Bay Area, I'd stop up, and we'd stay with them, visit, and, you know, when he'd come through, he'd visit. It was just, you know, we kept in touch that way.
Did your kids, hang out, were they tight with each? Because he had kids, he was very good, he loved his kids very much.
He had a couple of beautiful daughters, yeah. And my sons would hang out. I got pictures of them hanging out, playing together and stuff. And he had a beautiful wife, Lisa, and stuff. And from what I understand, her and the girls had moved to Kauai, and I lost touch with them. But I wish him all the best.
Yeah, no, I mean, listen, it is what it is. I just know he poured. A lot of the songs he wrote early on for the Dead, they were definitely songs that were for his daughters.
Oh yeah, I said they were really. I get choked up when I watch him do some of those songs on YouTube and stuff. Still, I mean, it's pretty. The ones he's thinking about his daughter and stuff. It's pretty amazing.
Well, I mean, when you guys would just be riding back to the hotel, like. What were the things that you bonded? Were you guys Harley Davidson riders together? Like, were you just closing down the bars? I mean, I know the guy drank a lot, but I mean,
it wasn't that bad. And we'd go out, we just stayed till they basically shut down and go back. It wasn't anything that crazy. But no, Brent was into Harleys. He liked Harleys. I mean, unfortunately, I didn't have one. I used to have an old BSA 441 Victor, and that's probably the closest thing I ever had to something like that. But no, he was really into the bikes and all that kind of stuff. But We were just more friends. I mean, aside from the music and anything else, we just kind of, for some way, kind of connected and that we could just relax and be ourselves with each other. And him being in the Grateful Dead at that point, everybody wanted a piece of it, but we were just, we'd known each other before all that, so it was just kind of a casual thing, cool.
He the stuff that I read is that he never really ever felt, even though I mean, my favorite period of listening to the Dead is when Brent, that early 80s period when you were kind of back in Oregon, but, he for some reason, he just seemed, he's on record saying he always was the new guy, never felt part of the band. I mean,
It kind of was like that, yeah. In the beginning in particular. I mean, I looked at Brent, too, and he was probably not wanting to come in stake out his territory too. So I'm sure. I mean, he just was kind of was real laid back, and he kind of handled it more like a sideman. And I think they were kind of okay with that, But I think as time went on, they realized he was adding another whole dimension to what the group was all about, and his writing added another whole dimension. And they started working in some of his tunes and letting him kind of, integrate, be more part of the band, and which I think was a good thing. I think Brent added a whole new dimension to the Grateful Dead in a good way, And
you don't got to tell me, man. I still have an analog tape deck in the car. I listened to what he did, just in and out of what you talked about, the way he would add these jazz chops just out of nowhere, this just filling it in, and he changed the whole percussive sound of the band. I was also going to say, I can't imagine what the sound expansion he must have given to Silver too. I mean, when you guys started to play together consistently.
Well, I mean, really, Silver. I mean, it was Brent was talented, but I mean, there was a. I mean, the whole. I mean, it was pretty. There was a lot of talent in that band, and when it was what kind of. I think with the Silver thing, part of the magic was the vocal blends was a big part of it. Just the way that the frequencies and everything and the vocals blending and the way we did that, we were a very tight vocal band. I mean, in my opinion, I mean, I think we stood right up there as good of vocal bands as out there, the Eagles and the different bands that were doing it at the time and stuff.
Wow. Yeah, that's, talk a little, why were you guys, would you open up more in a live setting? Is that why you thought you sounded better, just you were more exploratory, took more chances?
Well, no, actually we did the tunes pretty much like they were on the record, but I don't know if you've ever, you might have missed out on it when Poco was having their heyday, but in my opinion, one of the most electrifying bands live ever, explosive, just dynamite energy coming off of a stage was to get to see Poco back in the day when Richie Furay was singing in the band, and those guys had everybody up off their seats smiling and just rocking out, but they could never... The way that the sound was live, I mean, they could never capture that. I don't know how to explain it. A lot of the stuff on the record kind of seemed like it was almost filtered. Certain things would get cut off, frequency. It just it didn't have the same punch.
Sure.
And with our Silver album, I think the album stands up, and it's a really good album and in all that regard. But when we were played live, we just had more of an edge to it, and it was more real sounding, not studio. I don't know how to explain it, but it was, we were one of those bands that had that going for it.
You know, talk a little bit about what you're working on right now. I mean, insofar as, you know, where is it you know, what kind of life experience drove you to start creating again?
Oh, well, musically, mean?
Yeah.
Oh, well, I mean, as I mentioned earlier, I was, I grew up in a musical family. My dad's whole family, they grew up in, he was from Oklahoma, and, but my dad's whole family, when he was younger, back in, I think, the 30s, they played on those Grand Ole Opera radio, live radio shows. They used to do, you know, play for those. And so when I grew up as a kid, every weekend it'd be, you know, uncles and aunts over, cousins and stuff, and they would always seem like they had their guitars and mandolins and fiddles, and they'd be sitting there playing music, and it was kind of neat to be around a lot of that and be exposed to that. And, you know, I was 5 years old, you know, 4 or 5, watching Elvis Presley on TV. And so I was, from the early age, I was really into music, and I had a passion for it. And,
wow. They were playing, like, they were playing bluegrass music?
Well, I wouldn't really call it bluegrass.
Like country gospel, yeah.
It was kind of more mountain music, more just old, you know, country western stuff. And, I mean, my dad was, one of his cousins, his name was Miller, he was in Bob Wills and the Texas Playboys.
Wow.
My dad was really in a lot of that country swing and country western and stuff like that. But they would get together, just, you know, they'd jam out, play, you know, at the time, you know, I guess up to date songs or whatever, as well as some of the old stuff. But I was exposed to that, which was the good thing. And for me, I took a few guitar lessons in third grade, and that became boring for me, so I just started basically teaching myself how to play. And then when I was about 8 years old, my mom stuck me and my sister taking piano lessons. And I did that until I was about, I don't know, about 14, I guess, or some 14 and a half, 15, around there. And I wanted to play rock, so I started to, back in the old garage band things, back when I was, 15 years old, surf bands and stuff like that. And then the Beatles happened, and then we started doing, you know, some of those tunes, and the Zombies and the Kinks and the Birds and all that. And then in high school, actually when I was in the band, garage band though, the guys in the band wouldn't let me sing. They thought I had a weird voice, so I wasn't singing back in those days. And then during high school, I was really into groups like Green, The Doors, Iron Butterfly, Jefferson Airplane, you know, Grateful Dead, Stones, Beatles, all that kind of stuff. But The Doors in particular, I was really into The Doors, and I used to try to imitate him, Jim Morrison, and I got where I could do a pretty good imitation of Jim Morrison.
Right on, man.
So even though I wasn't really considered a singer, I found out, well, if I sang like that, people thought it was okay or whatever, so I could... I had a band in high school, this girl named Linda Easley, and she could play all the keyboard stuff just like Ray Manzarek. And so we did some Doors, so we did that. And then during my college years, actually that last year of high school, I was on a trip to Bass Lake with my girlfriend I had at the time and their family, a bunch of friends, and 4th of July weekend, and I ran into Osley. He's called Bear.
Wow.
Up there, and we connected with him with something that was kind of made the trip interesting, so to speak.
Wait, and, how about, I mean, like, how did that even come about?
To be honest, I don't even really remember. We were in the town of Bass Lake, and met some people, and we were looking to do something and get something, and somehow they led us to him. And
okay, so you were in pursuit of something. You found the right guy.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And definitely the most right guy I could have probably found. But anyway, it was an interesting trip to say the least, but I used to go to school with Johnny Gale and his sister Sherry Gale, and we all went to a private school, a bunch of us, and they all had cabins up at Bass Lake, and her dad was like the vice president of Chris Craftwood or something. We were all over at her house partying down in her game room, and then we started walking back and started getting towards sunset. We had to go back to my girlfriend's cabin, and walking through the woods, the sky was on fire, just crazy colors, and then we were in a interesting frame of mind, so to speak, and come drifting through the woods is the Buffalo Springfield playing, and that just, like, blew me out of the water.
Wow, it was really playing.
Yeah, it's the Buffalo Springs Bill, and so that's what kind of captured me with that start of that whole.
Sure.
Well, that's what I want to do. I want to do music like that, and that's kind of what led me to start doing my own music. And I was pursuing that when I ended up meeting Brent and John and all those guys, and you know, that's how that happened. So.
Do you think that we were a healthier society when we were eating more acid?
I wouldn't necessarily say that. I mean, there's. You know, I mean, it served its purpose. I mean, you know, we've gone through, you know, different times and, you know, realizations about different things or whatever. But, I mean, I think sometimes things in a certain time and place could be appropriate or whatever. I'm not inclined to be that way anymore. But, I mean, it was an eye-opener for me, you know. And, you know, for like a lot of things in that regard, it just got where it wasn't really fun anymore.
Right, yeah. Right, exactly. No, I'm talking more about like the consciousness and the open-mindedness. I mean,
Well, that was the whole time things were changing like crazy back during the 60s, and even, you know, from the music on, that whole era and stuff, and the people's consciousness, and it was a cosmic time, I think. I mean, things were happening, I liked a lot of what was going on, but, you know, back then, but also a lot of it kind of got too abused, I think, and caused a lot of people to burn out, and, we lost a lot of people along the way, you know, and I think people need to have more of a balance in different things, in my opinion, about stuff, I definitely think it serves your purpose, you know, but it's maybe for the time, I don't know. It's just, I'm sure I wasn't like a lot of the deadheads and stuff that was crazy about a lot of stuff, but I did my damage and my share and stuff like that, but it was, it wasn't something I would say that I needed to be inspired to play music.
Sure.
Or anything.
Like sure.
That, there's things I've, more natural, I would be inclined to be more, you know. But this. Speaking of that, I mean, this guy's talking about Johnny Gill. He was living in Laguna. He was, kind of head of the Brotherhood down there, and him and Timothy Leary were good buddies down there. So
really,
yeah, it was interesting times, you know. Yeah.
What was that? I mean, how did that stuff? Without getting in too deep into the history, I thought Leary was based on the East Coast. You're saying, but he had places all over
Him and Johnny, him and Johnny were good buddies, and there was a lot of craziness going on, and they had the Mystic Arts. It was like a head shop, kind of a trippy place down on Laguna Beach, and it was just interesting times, you know.
But I guess the better point was that it was when you first started tripping out, it was legal.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah, it actually was. And for a while it was, yeah. And then that all changed. But a lot of that stuff was going on back then. What can I say? I mean, it was just kind of the times and stuff. And it was a very magical time. I mean, 1966 and 67 were probably some of the most magical times I can remember, experiences and just things going on and stuff. And it was, I don't know, I'm pretty much the same person I've always been, though.
I get that feeling. I can see it in your face, man. I think you've lived, I think you've lived every, I think you've lived in the moment the best you can, you could, you've, can, you have, you know, you've aged well. And, you know, like you said, it's just a lot of cats. You can't.
To be honest with you, I had pretty much, when the band broke up and stuff, I had kind of pretty much got out of the music for, as far as, a lot of the guys were actively doing things, like Brent was in the Dead, and John Batchelor, he's been really active the whole time, whether he's doing, music soundtracks and music for TV shows or writing songs or whatever. He's been doing it all along, and Harry's been doing it all along, and maybe Tom kind of, he was still teaching and doing things like that, but, for me, I, kind of took a different, you know, direction. I almost, it was actually, I think, because of John Badger, actually, he was the one who kind of hooked me up with it. But I was asked to come down and audition for the Flying Burrito Brothers, somewhere around 79 or 80 around then.
Get out of here.
No.
With Sneaky Pete and those guys?
Well, I'm not even sure who was. It wasn't the original band. I mean, they went through a lot of incarnations or whatever, but they had me come down to L.A., and I hung out for a couple weeks waiting for them. They were on tour at the time playing New Zealand, Japan, and Australia. I was just waiting for them to come off tour. We were supposed to get together, but then supposedly when they got off the tour, they all had pneumonia or sick or whatever. But after a couple weeks of hanging out down there, I just finally had to say, I can't do this. I got to get back home. So I split, and then I found out later on they had broken up is what had happened, so it never happened. But almost did that, and then because of John Badger, again, another opportunity that came my way. The first edition, the band that Kenny Rogers used to be in, they broke up somewhere in the 70s. I forget when it was. And Kenny left the band, and they all kind of pursued their own things for a while. But they kind of reformed the band in the early 90s. Original band, not the original band, but it's a band back together with some of the people. And while they were getting that back together and doing it, Ken Bassey, one of the main guys in the first edition, he had passed away from lung cancer. So I got a call from these guys. I came home from work one time. I was selling copiers. That's what I did.
Sure.
Came home from work, and my son, who's now 36, he's about 14 or something. He goes, "Hey, Dad, some guys from the first edition called. They want you to try out for their band." And I just kind of poo-pooed it, went in the kitchen to grab a beer. And then my wife at the time, she says, "You're not even going to call or anything?" I said, "No, it's been 15 years since I've been doing that. And I don't think you really want me out touring and this and that." She goes, "Why don't you give them a call? You're better than selling copiers." So I called them, and I guess they'd been auditioning a bunch of different people. And for whatever reason, they liked me, and I joined up with the band. So we were together kind of quite close to 2 years, and used to do all the old hits, the first edition hits. We played the Del Mar Fair, the Las Vegas Hilton. We did some like 64 shows at State Line Buffalo Bills over there. And we just did some playing around, and then that finally... Jana, the female vocalist in the band, her and her husband moved back to Nashville, and that kind of put some squash on that. So we kind of, the first edition fizzled out again.
What was it like to get back out on the road and perform again after that much time?
Music is my passion. I mean, I have to say, since I was a kid, that's what I wanted to do. And it was a real thrill to be able to do that, And I really... I just really appreciate it when I get to do stuff like that. And I, as I mentioned, I was selling copiers. I did that, after my wife died. I really couldn't be even thinking about pursuing music and going out and touring and stuff like that. So I cut my hair and put on a suit and tie, and I did the old, regular thing for close to 30, about 27 years or whatever.
Your son is the same age as me.
Which, my 36-year-old?
Yeah, 36, yeah.
He was born in 78.
78.
And my oldest son was born in 75. 75, 78. And then I got a 17-year-old son, too, from my second wife I have.
Are you close with all of them?
With all my sons?
Yeah.
Well, my 17, he's still living here with me at home. And then my other two sons, I'm very close with them. And they just got back from Japan just a couple of days ago. In fact, my oldest son, he's still in Japan. He stayed over there for a while longer, but they're very close. I teach karate is what I've been doing for, next year will be 50 years since I started martial arts and karate and different things. But I've been teaching that for a lot of years, and I do that in the evenings. And my one son, Cody, he does karate with me, so I get to train with him and still see him. So it's nice, to do that.
When was the last time you... You and Brent had a conversation?
Well, as I mentioned to you earlier, it was the month right before he passed away when they were playing at Autzen Stadium up in Eugene, Oregon. He was in the hotel room there, and that was it. That was the last time I saw him. Then that was kind of a rough time, actually, for me, because during that time, I lost a close aunt of mine, and my dad passed away, and then Brent passed away, and then another really good friend of mine, Gary Usher, who used to produce the Birds. And
yeah, right. I know. Yeah, right, right.
He wrote some of the Beach Boys songs with Brian, and In My Room, a lot of 409, a lot of the songs he helped write, and songs for the Hondells, but he passed away. So it was like, you know, within about 3-4 months, I lost like four really, really close people to me, and it kind of was, you know, a hard time, but part of life, you know, what do you do?
No, I was going to say, like, when I interviewed Densmore, I asked him about his last conversation with Morrison, because, you know, he says he occasionally will have dreams where Jim will come to him in his sleep and talk to him, ask him, you know, and it gave him some of the impetus to push back when Manzarek and Krieger wanted to go out on tour as the Doors. But I just was wondering, like, in your day-to-day, I mean, again, sort of, even though music is your passion, you know, still pouring your time into karate with your kids, your spirituality, you know, does Brent come to you? Do you guys communicate in some way still?
I mean, I'm maybe not the good person to be talking about that kind of stuff. I don't know, but I mean, I wouldn't say that, but I mean, he's one of those people that I hold very, very close to my heart, and I think about him pretty much daily. I mean, every day, and I'm still, you know, checking out his songs on YouTube, and you know, in that regard, I mean, I've had dreams about Brent along the way, and different things, and not just only him, but other people, and things that seem, you know, kind of cosmic, I guess, or, you know, neat experiences, things like that, but Brent, for me, it's kind of a sad thing. I mean, because, you know, he was a beautiful person, and had so much going for him in so many different ways, and, you know, but yet, you know, I guess he was feeling the, you know, a lot of pressure that people feel in his position, and, you know, he had his own demons and struggles, and he was, you know, just like anybody, other human, but, you know, he was just I can't really say Brent was like a real, he wasn't one of those kind of guys that talked about spirituality much or things too much when you talk about him and stuff like that, and I'm sure he had that side to him. It was probably very personal. His dad was a minister, you know, so much like Jim Morrison, you know.
That's what his dad was a chaplain in the army too.
No, Brent's father was a minister. Jim Morrison, I'm mistaken on that. He was in the service or something.
You know, Morrison's dad was in the Navy and or was a decorated serviceman, but they would never promote him because of Jim's. Because of his legacy, you know, he always was the rear admiral, always the rear admiral.
I never heard of that stuff. I've never even heard before.
Yeah, well, Densmore told me that. It was just like because during the trial, I mean, Manzarek and Krieger wanted to go back on tour and make a lot of money. That, you know, and Densmore's like, guys, we got a couple groovy cars, we got some nice houses, you know, we're all set for life. You know, there's no way, and you know, he's just like Morrison. Morrison, you know, he was standing up for Jim because he just basically said that when in 67 when they signed the, Morrison was in Europe, and they Buick wanted them to sign a contract to use their Light My Fire song, and the three of them, it was like $75,000 at that time, as you know, huge amount of money, and so they jumped on it, and Morrison got back and was just livid, and said, you know, he called the lawyer. He's like, get rid of the contract. We're not selling out. And he looked at the guys. He goes, by the way, the record company, I guess Elektra, he's like, they want to fire all you assholes. He goes, let's fire them. And so it wasn't Elektra, it was somebody else. So they dumped the record company. But that was the solidarity that Morrison. And then Morrison said, I can't write a song, so we're just going to credit the Doors. I mean, he didn't get. You look at any of the credits on those songs, it's all the Doors. So when Krieger and Manzarek wanted to go back on tour as the Doors to make a few more million dollars, Densmore took him to court, and then they sued him for $40 million.
Holy smokes! That's one of the
yeah.
That's one of the dark sides, I guess, of the music business or whatever. I mean, music is to me, you know, kind of a special magical thing, but then you got the business side of it and all that other nonsense. It's just kind of could squash a lot of that, you know. I don't know.
Well, what he said, well, you can relate this to your own life, but it's like, you know, guys like you and Brent, Manzarek. I mean, I know Brent was a huge Manzarek fan, actually, I think. But, you know, you guys grew up, those guys grew up as well, very, very blue-collar, very middle class. And Densmore said once they got the gold ring, they started to hold on so damn tight they could never let go of it. And anytime you would, no, I'm with you. I mean, I'd love to get your thoughts on that, because, I mean, to me, it's like you get to a point.
To be honest with
you, yeah.
I was just going to say, to be honest with you, I mean, it's that can get that way. I mean, the very first tour that I ever went out with Silver, we were touring with America, but we were crossing paths with a lot of different bands, so you get to see a lot what goes on and stuff like that. And I'm looking, a lot of these guys are making all this money and having all the success, but a lot of the guys just didn't seem like they were really all that happy, you know.
Sure.
And doing different things and stuff, and I just start thinking, you know, I didn't know, do I really want to do this, you know, because I love music, but I don't want it to become like that. And I almost quit that very first tour.
Folks, welcome back to the Jake Feinberg Show, part two here, Greg Collier, and yeah, I talked to bass player Leland Sklar last night, and he, I asked him how he defines the term love, and I wanted to ask you about love. What was something that you saw in your career, in any career? It could be karate, it could be stuff you did in the middle or in music, that you would define as love.
For me, that's a pretty simple one. That was my first wife, Bernie. She was the most incredible human I ever saw. I mean, she was with me during the time I was with Silver and all that. And once in a while in your life, and you're lucky to meet somebody special, and that was her. You know, kind of a cut above everybody else in a lot of ways. I experienced that from her, and that's carried me a lifetime. And you know, as far as the band and things like that, you know, we got a lot of love from the fans and stuff like that.
Mm.
I mean, we had like a little entourage of our friends and stuff, the local fans who would, I mean, some of these, I mean, I can name some of them. One of them comes to mind is Charlotte. You know, she, there's a whole bunch of girls that used to, and little guys too, but I mean, there's this one group of girls who were hardcore fans, and they used to, you know, literally get in the car and drive, you know, the different states and stuff to come see our band play.
That's awesome.
Like
that's awesome. That's classic.
Yeah, they would always make sure they had new dresses, you know, some new pretty dress on for each show and try to do something special. It was interesting, but one time they went back to see us play at Red Rock with America. I think it was, we were playing somebody, Doobie Brothers or something. I think maybe America back there. But the show got canceled, and they didn't know that, and they were driving back there anyways, and it was storming and stuff, and they ended up driving off the mountain and crash in their car, but they ended up being fine. But
wow. Whoa. That's crazy.
Yeah.
No, I was going to ask you, that tour, I wanted to touch on that because when I talked to Batdorf, he talked about doing the 20,000 seaters with Sebastian on the America tour.
Some of those crowds were like 25,000.
Were those the biggest crowds you'd ever played in front of?
Yeah, for me, for sure.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow. Well, talk about that tour. What are your memories from that?
Well, that was actually our first big tour, and it was pretty scary for me. The very, very first time I ever had to walk out in front of 25,000 people, they almost had to use a cattle prod and push me out. I was so dang scared. I'm thinking, if I make a mistake, you know, I got 25,000 people are going to see me make a mistake, and somebody said, if you make a mistake, nobody even know it's you. Just keep playing, you know. And
sure.
Anyways, we went out there. We got started. And the crowd went wild, nuts, and it's just the energy that they were given off was just amazing. And it just lit us all up, man. We just all got into it, and had a great time. It was a lot of fun. And that's one thing amazing about a good crowd. They could just really pour a lot of energy into what you're doing and make it a lot more fun, you know.
Would you guys, like, when you were on the tour bus and stuff, were you listening to other, what kind of music were you listening to? I find that fascinating about at least some of the cats that I talked to. You know, they were listening to everything from psychedelic rock. I mean, not so much in the mid-70s, you know, I'm talking more like early 70s or late 60s, but I mean, it was just such a, the freeform radio concept had not completely gone away. You know, you could still hear Cannonball Adderley with, you know, Ray Charles, Peter Paul, and Mary. You had more diversity, and I just wonder if you got what kind of music you guys were listening to, like in between the shows.
Well, for me, it's basically the same thing I'm still listening to these days. I'm a hardcore Buffalo Springfield, Poco, Neil Young, Souther Hillman, Frey, Eagles, Firefall. You name it, anything in that vein. That's what I like to listen to for myself, but. There's even some new stuff out nowadays. It sounded really good, too. But as far as back in those days, I mean, that's pretty much what I was listening to, Bob Dylan. I still, you know, liked a lot of the classic acts that were out, you know, Fleetwood Mac and all that stuff and, you know, different things like that.
But that's why you and Batdorf connected, because he was a Springfield nut, too.
Oh, yeah. It was kind of the way we kind of played off each other. It was kind of interesting because he had more of a, you know, more of a voice, probably more akin to like a Stephen Stills type voice.
Right.
I had a little different kind of voice. It's just the way that the blends worked out, and the way he played and the way I played was kind of a neat balance of stuff. You know, I wouldn't say we're in the same league as the Buffalo Springfield, but we sure appreciated what they did, and I know they affected what we did a lot. You know, and the Beatles, John Batchelor was big into the Beatles, and you know, I like just about everybody else coming up out of that era. You know, we're affected by all the great groups, the Rolling Stones, the Beatles, Jimi Hendrix, you know, Grateful Dead, you know, all those great groups, the Doors. I mean, there was so much to draw from. It was an amazing time, you know, musically speaking, I think.
Yeah, and I think that people hadn't started building walls around themselves, you know? I mean, and that had a lot to do with society. I don't know, that's the part that kind of, it's crazy too. I mean, you could wind up at the Golden Bear, you know, in Huntington Beach or something, and you know, Paul Butterfield be there, like big names. Yeah. But people weren't like obsessing, and there was no paparazzi, and like people would let people borrow instruments. I mean, it was just there's people could talk to each other. And now, how did we get all holed up like in the isolationist kind of thing? How did that start? I mean, because it wasn't. Go ahead.
I look at it, it's just where the whole society, the whole pendulum swinging with, you know, society and the mindset and hearts of a lot of people and stuff. I mean, I think there's still people aware and attuned and sensitive and different things like that. And I think a lot of people nowadays are starting to wake up, see things a little more clearly. But there's been a lot of self-indulgence and just, you know, in my opinion, narcissism and a lot of other things along the way, you know. And I mean, I'm not putting myself above any of that stuff because I've had my own, you know, demons and stuff I've had to work with and stuff, you know, and try to be a better person as much as I can be. But, you know, it's just, music's one of those kind of things that a lot of the stuff that was happening back in those days, it's timeless. It still stands up, in my opinion, nowadays. I still enjoy listening to a lot of the stuff. And
mm-hmm.
In a way, that's the way it touches people and brings people together and people connect to certain feelings and stuff that they hit a nerve that, you know, resonates with everybody. And music's just, to me, it's a pretty magical thing. It's been a real motivator for me my whole lifetime, you know, even though I haven't always been in a position to pursue it like I would like to, you know. Fortunately, now I'm able to do that more at my age and stuff and start getting back into it more, which is kind of a nice thing.
How did you meet your wife?
Bernie?
Yeah.
I think I mentioned last time I actually had gone up to see John Batdorf and Mark Rodney, Batdorf and Rodney, the whole group.
You met her at that show, that's right.
At that show there, and that's, we connected there, and, you know, during that time I was, you know, dating a lot of girls, and I've had a lot of friends and different things like that, but she had a, you know, she just, there was something about her heart, and she had something that's, you know, just really touched me in a special way that even though at that point in my life I wasn't looking to necessarily to settle down or anything like that, it's one of those things she kind of captured my heart. And, no, it was...
That's cool. No, it's because you were like, it was a gravitational pull. There's no way...
Well, people, you know, anybody that knew her along the way, you know, they know what I'm talking about, but, you know, there's, she's one of the most rare individuals I've ever met in my lifetime. And
What made her rare?
it's kind of, don't have enough time here to get into it. But she was basically just a very sweet, honest person, a very caring person that, when you talk to her, she, honestly, you could tell that she was, you would touch, and that she honestly cared about what was going on with you. It wasn't somebody who's just, you know, she could give you advice that was almost sounded like you're getting it from God or something when she talked to you about stuff. You know, she was very kind, but she wasn't a pushover. You know, people over mistook that and found out quickly that wasn't the case. But she was just a real unique individual as far as her honesty and sincerity and her clarity that she had. And, you know, she's what I think most people, you know, would strive to be good would try to be like somebody like her, I would think. Oh, I mean, I'm fortunate I got to know her for a while, and my sons got to have her for their mother for a while, and stuff like that. But, you know, you never get enough of that.
No, you know, and I wanted to ask you, you know, do you, can you talk about some recent projects that you have on the horizon coming up? I feel like you made a very prescient point there with the idea that the music lives on, and then new things bubble up to the surface as well. So, you know, I'd love to just tell me about some of the projects you're working on.
Oh yeah, well, I mean, back in, you know, obviously in Silver, a lot of the tunes and stuff I was writing about was about Bernie, and there's still probably some of that even nowadays. But I've got after the band broke up, and she passed away. I mean, after the point she passed away, and I kind of was not able to continue pursuing the music type of thing. I just kind of put that part of my life on hold, and, you know, I cut my hair and put on a suit and tie and did that for quite a few years. But I would still occasionally, I would be, you know, gifted with a song that would come to me, and I'd write songs down, and, you know, I kept writing songs. And I had a really good friend of mine, Glenn McCready, who I've known since before I was even in Silver, back when I used to live in Carbon Canyon, even before I met Bernie, my wife, and everything. But we've been dear friends for a long time. But he's also a musician, but he's, by trade, he's been a printer, you know, an offset printer, and done things like that. But he built this really nice studio. He has an old Victorian home up in Portland. And down in the basement, he's built this very nice studio. And we're old school, so he's got an old, he bought a Studer two-track analog. And so he had kept bugging me for years to, you know, do something with my music, and I just kind of poo-poo him off. And he literally came down from Oregon one time and showed up at my doorstep with a portable recording outfit and made me sit down and start recording these songs that I've been writing. And so it's been a long project we've been working on for quite a while, a project of love. But it started out, I thought it was just going to be putting my songs down just to at least have them on some type of recording, so when I'm dead and gone or something, at least my kids could say, hey, my dad wrote that song or something. But anyway, I didn't know it was going to turn into what it's turned into, but he ended up taking what he'd recorded over to Arizona, Scottsdale, to another mutual friend of ours, Michael Lewis, another musician friend. And Michael started laying down other vocals and guitar parts and drums and bass and pianos, and his daughter put some cello and different things. And then Glenn took it back up to Portland, and we've had other friends participate and, you know, help out with the project along the way. But it's turned into full-on production. Yeah, we kind of did it bass-ackwards, you know, instead of cutting the rhythm track first and all that. I just sat down acoustically and just ran through the song. So, you know, there's been a few things we've had to deal with because of that. But it's, all in all, the project's shaping up into something I'm pretty proud of. And it's, I know it's been a long time coming. A lot of people probably believe it's never going to come out, but it actually is getting pretty close to being completely done now, and I think it'll be something worth listening to when it comes out. It's going to be called Songs from the Blind Trail. And
was it very quick realization, like, that when Michael was like, you know, I want to add some additional people to play, you know, to lay down lines, like, you were totally comfortable with that from the beginning? Because it seemed like it's like more like a communal thing at this point, you know?
Well, the whole thing turned out, the whole project's turned out to be that way. It's really amazing the people have been involved in it, the quality of musicians.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we've got. I mean, Glenn's been working on it the whole all these years, and but we've had a lot of people add besides vocals and string parts and drum, just every instrument about you can think of, pedal steel. A good friend of mine, Tom Lant, who has played with Steve Marriott. He's played with Paul Cotton's band.
He's his pedal steel player.
Yeah, he did some pedal steel, and he also did some just really nice guitar work on there too.
Wow.
Amazing. He lives down in San Diego, but he's got, he does his own stuff too. His name's Tom Lant, but great player. So we've had just a lot of neat people contribute to the project, and it's been done out of the love of their heart. I mean, when I think about this, it amazes me how this whole thing's kind of come about, and it's really getting finally at the point I'll actually be able to put it out and let people listen to it. So I'm kind of excited about
it. How would you describe the, are there opportunities where it opens? I guess what I'm trying to say is you laid down you sang with vocals and an acoustic, but is there opportunities for the song to open up for improvisation as well?
The way the whole thing kind of came about, there was no charts. I didn't tell anybody what to play. They just played whatever they, whatever they wanted to play.
Right.
And it just seemed to work out. I mean, we kind of had ideas for, some of the parts and things like that, but as far as, I was down here in California, and people were up there going to Glenn's studio, and just, the next thing I know, he'd send me down, hey, look, I put this on, I put that on. Whoa, that's cool, and it's just, it kept shaping up that way.
I'm looking forward to hearing it, man. I definitely will do my best to support it on new media, I mean, this is, in some ways, I get to live out this fantasy in real time, I mean, it's brilliant, I never would have been able to connect with you guys back, in the silver days, the way I've actually been able to find you. I found Batdorf, and then I just was reading somebody's comment, like, this is going back a few weeks, about Brent, and someone's like, Greg Collier was really close with Brent. I was like, who the heck, Greg Collier? And I started to do, I started to dig. I'm like, well, the next thing we're hanging, and that's a beautiful thing, man. It's nice to know that you've affected a lot of cats that basically just, it's a legacy project. This is absolutely a legacy.
I'm kind of proud of it, and I don't know if anybody else will, what they'll think of it or not. But as far as what I've seen people contribute and how it's shaped up, it's something I feel really good about. And just mentioning some of the people that have been involved, a couple other people. There was a one of the guys that actually engineered the two Platinum Journey albums. He worked with REO's Speedwagon. He did the Steely Dan projects, their stuff. He helped engineer.
Who is this? What is his name?
What's his name?
Yeah.
It's John.
Full name.
Hold on a second here. I'm having a senior moment here.
Okay, don't worry about it.
John Neff. Yeah, he actually worked with that. He did all the music. He worked with Peter, what's his name, David Lynch films.
Sure.
Did the music for those, and he was in David Lynch's band. His name's John Neff, and he worked, as the record planner, one of the studios down in Sausalito area, down in the Bay Area, and but he also had a studio over with one of the guys in the Steely Dan over in Maui, and did a lot of recording with those guys over there. Well, he's worked with a lot of people, but he helped do some of the engineering on it. Another guy goes by the name of Joe Spain, is this kind of his stage name, but another guy that's worked with Chris Isaac and people like that, he's been helping out with it and stuff. So there's been a lot of really talented people with successful backgrounds in their own right that have contributed to it. So I've been real fortunate, and like I said, the way this thing has come about, and just people hearing what I do and they wanted to be involved and help out, it's been really kind of a neat way to do it. It hasn't been people sitting around watching the clock on the studio and that type of thing. It's been different. So.
That's right. No, it's been done in a very interesting fashion. Did you know if Brent's parents accepted his lifestyle or his career?
Well, I didn't really know Diedrich. That was his father. I didn't know them very well. I've met them just on a couple occasions, but they seemed like they were quite conservative, you know. I know his dad was a minister, I believe, and I'm sure, you know, it might have the same effect that I had on my mom. My parents were ruffling their feathers and stuff as far as, but I don't know. See, I didn't really know them, so I can't really, you know, say how they responded to him in that way, but there'd probably be some other people maybe better to talk about that.
Right. No, I mean, what I'm just fascinated about is, like, why you told that first story where Brent would just, you know, sort of be, like, just stewing about something, but he wouldn't necessarily be able to articulate it, go into a room and then create for like 4 or 5 hours and come out.
He would just go in and vent, but he'd come out in a form of a beautiful song. It was just like, you know, real touching. And I don't know, that's the way he seemed like he dealt with life. It'd come out in music and stuff, you know, and he had his own heartaches and things he had to go through and stuff. And, you know, but, you know, like a lot of musicians, they, you know, they write from their heart. And you know, I mean, I'm not one of those, some people could just formulate and say, I'm going to write a song about this or that. I can't do that. I have to feel something or have something come to me while I'm hearing it in my head and say, hey, that's kind of cool, and write it down. I can't just, I'm not too good at just sitting down, I'm going to write a song about this or that. It doesn't work that way for me. You know, you mentioned Leland Sklar, talking to him, what, night before last?
Yeah.
I had a chance one time, it was kind of cool to meet a bunch of those guys.
You
mentioned John Mosteri, we were talking about the original drummer for Bad Dwarf and Rod, we were talking about him, John White. And he had been drumming with Jackson Brown after he left our band, and his wife at the time, Nadine, she was Jackson's kind of like personal like secretary for dealing like his household things and, you know,
Sure. Keeping
things around the house, different things like that. So, you know, my wife used to get a big thrill when Nadine used to take her over to Jackson Brown's house and they get to, you know, go swimming or whatnot. And then next thing you know, here comes Jackson Brown jump in the pool naked and they get a big thrill from that, you know. So,
Sklar, because he played bass with that triggered that memory, or did you?
What I was going to say. What happened is like because of John. One time when I was living in Oregon, I bought this old 1959 Gibson Les Paul Jr. Melody Maker with a full scale neck. I bought there in Oregon, and I had it with me when I was down in L.A. But I was thinking about selling it. I mentioned it to my friend John. The drummer, he says, well, he thought maybe Jackson Brown might be interested in it because he liked old guitars. So John took me over to the studio one night where Jackson Brown was in the process of producing one of Warren Zevon's albums. I think it was his second album or something. But when we walked in the studio, there was Leland Sklar, Russ Kunkel, David Lindley, Waddy Wachtel, I mean, all these great musicians and stuff. And I was just, you know, blown away. And as soon as Leland saw this guitar and Waddy and also David Lilly, they all were freaking out about this old guitar had. They all wanted to keep taking turns playing it and stuff. It was kind of neat.
Oh, that's so, you know, because Collier, you know, my man, I'm telling you, you and Sklar, like those, Sklar is, people like you guys make the world go round, man. Those cats are just so humble. And like I asked him last night, I asked him, my show is about the 4 L's, leadership, love, life, and lineage. So I asked him about leadership, and he just talked about trying to always keep an upbeat attitude in the studio. And aside from his proficiency playing, you know, he just always interested, always wanting to learn, always keeping people fresh. You know, to me, like, that just made sessions, you know, he said, obviously compared to people that would show up and play a solo and then they would offer absolutely nothing emotive to the session at all. And I look back at that time and I say, those rhythm sections, you know, could have been Roger Hawkins and David Hood, you know, the Muscle Shoals guys.
I think a lot of what sets people apart from just being just a player and somebody that's kind of magic is they have that special heart, that feeling they put into what they do, that, you know, they bring to the table, that you can feel that when you hear it, you know, and it's not just mechanical, I don't think, you know, but...
Absolutely not. Yeah, I agree.
All these guys were hanging out that night. Jackson had to, he said he had to take off and leave for a minute, but he's going to be back. And he came back a little bit later on, and he had the first printing that he got of the first copy of Running on Empty album.
Wow!
And they're all tripping out looking at that. And one of the guys noticed that Russ Kunkel's drums that's on the front of that album. So one of the guys had noticed that they, when they put the photograph on there, they had reversed the negative, so everything was just flipped around backwards on there, but they were tripping out on that. But it was just hanging out with those guys, and Jackson was extremely, extremely nice. He bought my guitar from me, and it was just a neat experience getting to do that stuff, you know. Coming from where I was coming from, it was neat, you know. And I'm not even in the same league as those guys by any means, experience-wise or background or anything, but it's just kind of neat when you get to be in the same room with somebody like that and breathe the same air and listen to them talk and, you know, hang out with them. You know, it's cool.
No, I'm with you. How did you meet Mosseri or John White now?
Well, I met him just because they were part of the Bad Dwarf and Rodney band. They were, Rick Carlos was the bass player and John was the drummer, and then Brent was actually kind of the keyboard player. He was more of a side guy, and it was John and Mark were the main, they were the duo, the main part of the band. And, as I mentioned, when we first entertained, you know, having a group, we were just going to naturally use John and Rick, but, you know, later on our management had other ideas, and we went back to a trio type of thing before we added Harry and Tom
But you reconnect, yeah, you with Tom and but you reconnected with John after that.
John Baddorf?
White.
No, John. No. He actually, he comes. He plays with my band now. Sometimes he actually sits in and plays drums with me. Sometimes.
Oh my God! I gotta talk to that cat. We're just gonna.
I can hook you up. He's got a lot of experience. Man, he's done a lot of things. He's played with Hoyt Axton, Jackson Brown, Michelle Schacht, Michael Blue. But I mean, I could go on and on. A lot of different people. He's done stuff.
And he's a. I would be honored to connect with that cat. Just so, you know, but you know, because this is the lineage, man. You got, it just links in the chain. I think that's what I wanted to ask you about. Is you know, tell me about the things that why you enjoyed teaching karate now. Like, what is that? Would you consider that a passion for you?
Well, it has been since I was a young kid. You know what actually. Excuse me just for a second. What actually motivated me initially when I was 14 to get into martial arts was I just went to a rough school, and there was a lot of gang fights and just fights and, you know, getting ganged up on the way walking home from school and beat up. And that was stuff was going on all the time, and I just got tired of getting beat up. I was a skinny kid, kind of tall, but skinny guys like to pick on me. And so that's what initially got me into, you know, learning karate and martial arts. And I wanted to learn how to fight, but I've realized, you know, like I said, next year I'll mark 50 years since I've been started my journey, and I realize I'm still that same kid, basically, that I was when I was 14 that doesn't like to fight. Just because I've been doing this a long time, I'm by no means any kind of a expert or master or anything like that. It's something I really, really enjoy doing. It helps give me peace of mind. Doesn't matter how bad I'm feeling when I go to work out. I always feel better when I leave, and I know the students feel the same way. There's so much more to karate and martial arts than I ever thought about. I just always thought about the fighting part. I never thought about the health aspects, the calming of the mind, the flexibility, the coordination, the balance, all these different things. And it's something that could really, you know, enhance a person's life if they choose to do that. And it's something that's not like a seasonal sport. This is something you could do for the rest of your life. You know, it's for all ages, and you know, it's just, there's something to benefit for everybody, whether, no matter what you want to, you know, get out of it. But for me, just to be honest with you, I'm basically kind of a lazy person, and if I wasn't doing stuff like this, I would be home on the couch every night with the remote control, and you know, probably be dead already with, you know, heart attack or something.
Right. That's why that cat showed up at your doorstep, man. Because he had to drag, you out. But you do. But the point is, you do it. But were you interested in fighting or just self being able to credibly defend yourself against the gangs and stuff?
Well, just be able to defend myself is what motivated me to do it. And you know, I never thought about being a teacher, or, you know, sensei or any of that type of thing like that. That I've been teaching now for over 30 years, and my sensei is a very famous karate master from Japan. His name's Fumio Demura. In fact, I get the pleasure of next Wednesday, I get to go to a screening of the the movie that they made about his life. The documentary is coming out. It's called The Real Miyagi.
Wow.
So if you get it, you should check that out.
Wow.
And just look Real Miyagi. But in the, he did all the stunt doubles for Pat Morita in the Karate Kid movies. They originally asked him to play the part of Mr. Miyagi, and he turned it down because his English wasn't very good. But the Pat Johnson, who was one on Chuck Norris's black belt championship fighting team that Chuck used to have back when they used to compete a lot, he's one of the top stunt choreographers for the Hollywood, you know, martial arts movies and Dick Tracy, a lot of different movies and stuff. But he was working on the stunt choreography, and he was complaining to Chuck Norris one night on that he couldn't get the fight scene where the skeleton guys beat up the Karate Kid to look right. You know, he spent all this money. And so Chuck said, why don't you get a hold of Demo and see if he'll help you? So he called my sensei, and my sensei said he would do it if he could use some of his students. So some of the guys I trained with, they went up to L.A. with sensei, and they walked throughout the routine, a couple few times, and then they put on the makeup and got all ready to go, and they got the scene first take. So from that point on, my sensei actually did all the fight stunt doubles for Pat Morita in the fight scenes. That's actually him doing the fighting.
The original, you're talking about the original Karate Kid.
Oh, the Karate Kid movies, yeah.
Classic. And you were coming up as a karate, you were learning your art at that you were mastering your technique at that time.
Well, I mean, yeah, I was one of his, I've been one of his students for years and years, and I actually, you know, because of sensei, he actually, and Pat Johnson, Pat saw me competing several years ago at a tournament, and, you know, he asked my sensei if he could use me and some of the other guys from our dojo, and he was filming a movie called Showdown Little Tokyo. It had Bruce Lee's son, Brandon Lee, and Dolph Lundgren and Tia Carrera, so I got to do some karate stunt stuff in that movie, which is kind of neat. But I was still a single parent at the time, so I was had some more opportunities that were being offered to me, but it would have been like the music. Again, I would have been touring and traveling, so I had to turn them down, you know. So, but it was still fun to get to try it out and to do it.
Dolph Lundgren? You got to hang with that dude? That dude's legendary.
Yeah, Dolph Lundgren and Bruce Lee's son, Brandon Lee, the one that got shot. Yeah, he was super, super nice. Tia Carrera, she's done a lot of movies, Wayne's World, and a lot of different
things. Oh, my God, dude. We're learning more and more about Collier every day. So you, yeah. I mean, this is awesome. No, because I was going to say, I mean, the karate.
Well, my sensei in Japan, I mean, this is pretty unusual. I mean, he's the first time in history that they've ever gone outside of Japan and awarded he's considered a living treasure, which is a real high honor. And they usually only award that to black belt masters living in Japan. Well, they came to the United States and awarded him that honor. So he's a real unique individual. He was a 1961 All Japan number one fighting champion from 61 to 64. He was like the top fighter in Japan before he moved over to the United States and started teaching. And he taught Bruce Lee the nunchaku. Steven Seagal was one of his students. Chuck Norris trained with him. You know, I could go on and on. And Steven McQueen taught him how to ride a motorcycle up here where I live. So he's playing with Steven and all those guys. He's a real character, yeah. He's a neat guy.
Oh my gosh, that is so funny. I mean, I was going to say, because, I mean, the karate got on the map because of the Karate Kid. I mean, that popular.
Well, yeah, that and the nunchuckle, the weapons that everybody does nowadays, became popular after Bruce Lee used it in Enter the Dragon.
That's right.
And he learned that my sensei. So my sensei is the first guy, the first Japanese teacher to bring not only our style, Shitoryu, to this country in 1965. He was also the first Japanese sensei to bring over all the weapons and start teaching and demonstrating all the different weapons, the Sai, the nunchaku, tonfa, ekubo, kama, all these different weapons that everybody just does, and you can buy in magazines and stores all over the place. Now he's the one responsible for that, so he's he's a heavyweight dude. I mean, as far as martial arts go, you don't get any better than that. He's done more to probably populate and spread karate around the world than anybody that I know. So
wow.
I've just had the pleasure of hanging because of knowing him and the other people that he brings into the picture for us to train with, and, you know, that I've had the pleasure to opportunities to know and to train with. It's been a wonderful, wonderful experience, you know, paralleling my experiences with music, you know, and the neat things I got to experience with that, you know. And real quick, I got another one little quick story.
Go
about one of the neat little things that I remember that sticks out in my head that just, I was always blown away because, you know, being in the studio with a lot of these other popular people and well-known musicians and successful and touring with these people and getting to play in front of all these crowds, you know, people looked at us, I'm sure, that we were something, too. I got a couple of stories for it. But this one in particular was one time it was really neat. We got to, we were in the studio working on one of John Batter's songs called Goodbye So Long, and we were doing the vocals, harmonies and stuff, and just right down the hall from us was David Crosby and Graham Nash. They were working on their second solo project called Whistling Down the Wire.
Sure.
And so while we were doing it, all of a sudden walks in our room with David Crosby, and these guys were coming down and checking and listening to us, and, you know, when they were taking breaks from what we're doing. So then we got to go down and listen to what they were doing when they were taking breaks. It was kind of neat. And I was just, if you can imagine this, inside, I was, these guys were my idols, you know, all these musicians I was hanging with, David Crosby and Stephen Stills, all these different guys. And I'm trying to act like it's an everyday thing. I'm just, you know, one of the guys. But inside, I was always ready to bust a button. I was just trying to explode. And we're sitting there in the studio, and Graham was in the engineering booth working on a harmonica part with the engineer. They were trying to get this part down. And David's out in the other main part of the studio with us. And he started telling me about this guy he met back in Florida when he was sitting on the dock back there. They came up to him with some amazing guitar, and, you know, he said he was a guitar, he built this guitar and wanted David to try it. So David played this guitar and said it was the most amazing guitar he'd ever played. So he went back and drags out this guitar to show us. And he started, next thing I know, we're sitting around cross-legged on the floor, and he's tuning this guitar to some weird tuning. The next thing I know, he's playing Guinevere for us. And I'm ready to just, I was so freaking blown away. We all were. We're just hearing this beautiful sound come out of this person. And just, I was just, you know, I can't even tell you what a thrill.
What a great story. That's a mind blower right there. No,
I mean, yeah. Seriously, I mean, I've always heard the stories about what a, you know, pain that David was to work with and deal with stuff. That guy was always so nice to me. It was always a pleasure to be around that guy as far as I was concerned. And Graham Nash was super nice. I mean, all these guys were super nice. It's just, you know, I mean, I'm sure other people tell this experience, but my experiences were pretty positive, just to let you know.
No, I think, but this is, you jarred my memory, because talking to Leland last night, you know, he said the same thing you're saying right now. He goes, I would, you know, he would walk, he always thought it would be a trip that he'd walk into these places and, you know, I can't even think of the guy, you know, Phil Collins or Paul McCartney, or, you know, someone's like, hey, what's up, Lee? Hey, you're Lee Sklar. It's great. I've always wanted to meet you. He's like, how the heck do they even know my name? You know, I mean, he took it almost one step further where it was like you're trying to act like somebody in the room. He still felt like it was weird. Like, they're like, hey, Lee, what's going on? You know, like how, why is this happening to me? And he was saying the same.
I always felt that way. You know, when I got to stand next to Timothy Smith in the booth and sing vocals, I mean, just all those kind of things. Just for me, it's a real thrill. I mean, and, you know, maybe you guys at some point get used to that. I don't know. I never did. It was a real trip. And I got one more funny story for you.
Please.
Because you know, guys would see us up playing on the stage, and I'm sure they thought we were, you know, big rock stars or whatever, and probably thought we were driving fancy cars and everything. Our band had the rattiest cars you ever saw. I mean, I had a 66 Volkswagen at the time. John Bathurst, I think he had like a 71 or 72 a Toyota Corolla, the little tiny one. And then Tom Ledden had a mustard yellow, an older Toyota Corona, I think it was, with a Corona. That he got from a junkyard, you know, on the thing. And then Harry at the time had an old 1961, I think, Chevrolet Biscayne with our backs in the thing so he could haul his drums around. So our cars were a joke, basically. And we kind of joked about, for the second album cover, we ought to line our cars up and get our pictures taken with all our cars, you know. But one time we were playing the opening, the Santa Monica Civic, we were opening for Poco there, and all the local, you know, fans come up to hear us and everything like that. And, you know, we're up on stage, they're throwing, you know, the flowers and the whole nine yards and everything like that. And then finally, you know, we get ready to leave, and we walk out the backstage door, and there's probably about 50 fans waiting to get our autographs and everything like that. And out in the parking lot, all these really nice, you know, Lamborghinis, and, you know, our manager had an Aston Martin, the other had a Porsche. It was all these, like, really nice cars. And then there were our old cars, our cars were out there. So we're like, signing autographs, actually, like, to put on rock stars and everything, right? And then finally we'd sign the last autograph. The people weren't leaving. They're just kind of hanging around, like, oh, well, now what do we do? We had to leave, you know? So we're walking across the parking lot to get in the car, and you should have seen the looks on their faces when they saw us getting these old junk cars. It was either our road manager manager, Stevie, had an old Saab, or my boat, so one of them would start, so we had to actually get out and push the car in front of the to get it started and talk about it. Embarrassing. And humbling at the same time, but a funny story.
Oh, know? My. What car did Brent have?
Brent had, actually, he had an old Ford Econoline. He had an old kind of primered, banged up Ford Econoline that he had.
Would he drive the bike to the shows too?
Harley? He had a Harley back then. That was later on after Silver broke up. That's when he started making some money. We never really made any money. That's a funny thing.
The people's like, we're gonna get these guys autographs, man, and then they're looking back, and you're getting into the rat cars, dude. I just love that. That's so classic.
Yeah, well, it's funny because our managers Hartman and Goodman. I'm not sure exactly what they did, but they had something to do with managing the Eagles when they first got together on Geffen Records, and they're involved in it somehow. But they used to tell us that our band reminded them a lot of the Eagles when they first started. You guys should hang a couple more tours, and this is all going to turn around and change and stuff. Well, we never, we never made it to that point. But it was, it's just funny how some of the other stuff that happened along the way.
Did you ever have a chance to play or hang out with Bobby Weir?
Well, I got to hang out with him. Yeah, man, we had some fun.
What was that? Tell me, like, the early years where Brent was in the. I mean, tell me a story with Bobby, dude. That guy. I interviewed Bobby. I mean, he's a trip, man.
Well, I mean, to be honest with you, I'm not one of Bobby's friends that would call him up and go hang out with him like that. I only knew him because of me knowing Brent, and I was only probably welcomed into the circle because of that whole thing and stuff like that. But they were very just down home, fun guys to hang around with. When I had that opportunity to do that and going out and partying with them and things like that. But I'll tell you a really funny story about Bob Weir. That,
please, yeah.
When I got out of the music for business for a while, I was waiting tables before I put on the suit and tie type thing. But I'd learned this cute little or neat little trick with wine corks. Where you take two wine corks and you hold them in your hand between your thumbs a certain way. And you lock your fingers through, make like a lock, and then the trick is to be able to take the corks apart without letting go of your fingers and things like that. And obviously it's an illusion.
Sure.
But I was doing this trick and showing it to Bobby Weir, and he was just messed up enough that he's like, "Whoa, show me that again." He just had to learn, and I kept showing it to him over and over. And we were drinking. I mean, they always had Rothschild's, Bordeaux, drinking the good wine, Cabernets and stuff back, real good wines and stuff backstage and stuff like that. But he was feeling no pain, and it was the funniest thing watching him trying to figure this thing out. Everybody was like laughing at him, and I kept showing it to him in slow motion, and he just couldn't get it. He was like ready to pay me some large sum of money or something just so I could teach him how to do it. He was all frustrated and stuff like that. It was so funny.
Oh my God, that's great. That guy, I mean, he is such an interesting character, and his personality was so tripped out. I can't even imagine what that backstage scene must have been like, especially when Brentford. I mean, what was, did you go the first year he joined the band? Did you check him out in 79?
Yeah, the whole time through. He was with the band. I got to go see him whenever he was around that I had the opportunity and things like that. And, I don't know. It might not, maybe not tell you, wild stories like they used to have back in the heyday in the 60s or whatever. It wasn't like that, maybe necessarily. But it was a lot of fun times, and guys were always horsing around. And I told you about that one time they had that doll of Jerry Garcia, made by the guy that did the Muppets or what, And they used to horse around and do stuff like that. But I never got to see Jerry much. He pretty much, kind of kept to himself, But the other guys pretty much hung out together
Yeah, I mean, like if you were, like, I'm just trying to get an idea of, like, if you were backstage, you kind of just let, even during set break, would they come back and go into their own, would you see Brent at that time or only after the show?
Oh, well, no, we'd hang out, actually, the dead, they take breaks during the show and stuff like that, so whenever they'd take breaks, I'd go from being out in front of the audience, or sometimes I'd be sitting up on stage just offside of Brent or something like that, watching them from on stage, but, so we'd go backstage and, maybe Mickey and Billy would be doing some drum solo or something, and some of the guys would be backstage, and then they'd take breaks, and then go back out and play again. And then afterwards, we'd go back to the hotel and hang out, and, you know, and hang out with everybody and do whatever we did, you know. And speaking of that, it's kind of a funny story that happened up in Portland one time. Do you remember when back when Mount St. Helens, or I don't know, maybe that was before your time, I don't know. But
No. 1980, it exploded. Yeah, the night of the show.
Yeah, well, during that time, I was living in Walport, outside of Walport, up on these 5 acres. I had a view of the ocean out one side of my house.
Oh, my gosh. Yeah, it's
pretty awesome. But we were like 200 miles away from Portland, and I was out working my garden. I had a garden at the time. And I was out in my garden, and all of a sudden I heard these explosions going off. I thought they were dynamiting in the next valley over or something like that. And it turned out it was Mount St. Helens erupting, and I heard it 200 miles away. In fact, we ended up getting ash and stuff on my cars and stuff clear down where I live.
Wow.
That was the first eruption, but the Grateful Dead were playing up at Portland, and so we went up to see the show, and I invited my friend, I was telling you about Glenn McCready, who has a studio up in Portland, and his wife at the time. And I had this old 61 Mercedes 220 SEB that was all, you know, kind of restored and fixed up. And I'd spent the morning washing and waxing it, getting it all pretty to go up to the show that night and stuff like that. So we went to the show, and then during, I knew that they're getting ready to take a break, so I started making my way this shortcut I was taking kind of under the rafters and stuff, getting back so I could go backstage and go back to hang out with them backstage.
Right.
And while I'm walking underneath the rafters, all of a sudden everything just started rumbling and roaring, and I thought their equipment was feeding back or something because they were playing the song Fire on the Mountain.
Oh, my God.
And all the equipment, everything, they're starting rumbling and roaring, but I thought it was like a feedback or something. And then by the time I got backstage, they'd finished the song, and they all come busting in backstage, and they all were excited as could be, because while they were playing Fire on the Mountain, Mount St. Helens erupted again, which was right by Portland. So that's what we were feeling, was the mountain going to explode while they were singing Fire on the Mountain.
I've read accounts of that, but for you to just paint that is for you to say that you were under the rafters and it was rumbling. And then
I thought it was their PA feedback or something when that was going on.
That is, but I mean, that was the kind of stuff they got off on. That's the kind of cast.
And when we were leaving to go back to the hotel, back where they were staying, the ash was coming down so thick you could not breathe or nothing. My car was completely covered, and my windshield washers weren't even, you know, I couldn't put it up. Glenn had to take his empty wine from the backstage and fill them up with water, and he's hanging out trying to pour water over the windshield so we could make it back to the hotel. It was crazy. It was wild. I mean, it was like being in a vacuum cleaner bag, but we finally made it back to the hotel and got out of that stuff. We all had sore throats the next day.
Oh, I mean, that's why. I mean, just, I'm still trying to, they were playing in, Mount St. Helens erupted, but they were playing in Portland, is that right?
Portland. Mount St. Helens is just basically on the other side.
That's right. It's in Washington. It's right across the pool. Yeah.
That's pretty close.
Did you go to, down to Eugene at all when you lived up there?
Did I do what?
Did you go down to Eugene, Oregon at all?
Well, when we very first moved up, my wife and family, after the band broke up, my folks had a place about 25 miles southeast Eugene. They had a little over 6 acres out there in Lowell, across from Fall Creek Reservoir. And we stayed there for maybe 3 months, which is, you know, close to Eugene. My sister still lives in Eugene, but I went and saw the shows when they played Otsum and stuff like that, the Grateful Dead shows there.
Yeah, there was also a venue called Silva Holt, too, a small venue, indoor venue. Very tiny one, but you might have moved back.
Yeah, that was another place, another Holt Theater. That was like a little small little place. They used to play there probably before they made it